I want to talk about oil. XStock One platform. Just off the coast of this coastal town, near the Yucatan, in the Yucatan, just off the Yucatan Peninsula. Relatively shallow, again, basically scuba diving depth with maybe a little bit of mixed gas diving. Probably get nitrogen narcosis if you went down on air that deep, but it's possible. Basically, deep water drilling platform has a problem, starts leaking, and everybody's super worried that it's going to destroy this fishing village and all these other areas. The red coastline that I've highlighted are the areas where we reported oiling, littoral oiling, beach oiling. But it's a little bit misleading in that, yes, some oil came ashore, but the vast majority of the oil went north because of luck of the draw. Because we had wind conditions that pushed the oil primarily away from shore. Also, that oil went mostly out to sea and was heading towards the U.S., but we had several months of notice ahead of time. People bombed this with dispersants, basically detergents to break up the oil and turn it from a big glob of oil to a bunch of smaller globs where microbes can have more easy access to the surface of the oil and have a greater breakdown potential. We have a fairly good idea about what this oil spill did with the weathered oil, meaning the oil that's been at the surface for a while and a lot of the more volatile components have left. So aged, do you think it's aged crude oil? Crude oil has all the fractions together. It has the heavy stuff, the light stuff, whatever. When that light stuff goes away, we refer to that as weathered. Most typically because the beating of ultraviolet from the sun and agitation from waves helps that process. So that's where the term weathered comes from. So the oil was weathered by the time it got to the coast, Texas coast, and the coast of that part of the country, the U.S., and we had resources. People were able to measure stuff before the oil came and then after it came. So most of the environmental impact from this comes from primarily the American sampling. Again, not as toxic, way farther away, manipulated. But again, with this, people are, oh my God, and this is exactly what you heard with the Deepwater Horizon. The equivalent of top hat, they call it a sombrero, a junk shot, all these things they're talking about, trying to jam stuff down the pipe and block the oil, all that jazz. Right, okay. Then we get to the Exxon spill, the 1989 Exxon spill. Two most important oil spills for U.S. coastal policy. Number one, the Santa Barbara oil spill. Number two, the Exxon spill. The Exxon spill is going to spur what's known as OPA 90. O, capital O, capital P, capital A, 90, which is the abbreviation for the Oil Protection Act of 1990. But let's talk about what happened with the spill itself. So the spill, again, a small fraction, about 15% of all the oil that was released from the Deepwater Horizon. I use the term spill here for you guys because that's what everybody uses, so I just use that. Let me just be clear. A spill is where we have something like in the Exxon condition, we had a known volume of oil. It was a barrel of oil. It was a train tank of oil. It was a cargo ship full of oil. And then that contained volume spills. It gets torn open, it breaks open, whatever, and is released. That's technically a spill. If we fill up that bucket with oil in the back, and you guys start carrying it to me, and you trip, and it goes to the ground, we call that a spill. A blowout is technically different. So the Santa Barbara incident was technically a blowout. The XStock example was a blowout. This is a true spill. Blowout because it's releasing from a reservoir and we don't know how much is going to be released. So when the Exxon, if a vessel comes up, loses power and crashes on our shore tomorrow, we know that the worst possible case is the total volume of oil in that ship. So we have some, we can wrap our arms around it. With a blowout, you can't do that. You have no idea if you're going to stop it tomorrow, stop it a week from now, stop it 3 weeks from now. So it's a much harder beast to deal with. Okay. Even though I'm using the term spills for a lot of these things. You'll see a lot of times I put the spills in quotes. In this case, it's a true spill. So we see a clear elevated toxicity to a lot of different groups. Again, birds that are alighting on the surface of the water or are on the shore. Marine mammals, in particular sea otters, because everybody likes the sea otters. They're cute and they're warm and they're fuzzy. And they do things that people think, that's so cute. Intertidal invertebrates, so just like Santa Barbara, the intertidal critters attached to the rocks. And in this case, particularly hit particular species of fish that are very vital to both the culture of the native peoples, the First Nations of that area, as well as modern societies. Incredibly important for the economy as well, not just subsistence for some folks, but actual, it's their living. And so this had a huge impact on those organisms. We learned a lot from some of these earlier oil spills, one of which was the importance of rapid mobilization. So as soon as this happened, a lot of those of us from California went up to go look at that spill. People from around the country came, and people knew what to do. Hey, throw down. We see the oil coming. Let's measure what the barnacles are like right now, the morning before the oil comes in. So we can compare the before the impact to the after the impact. That's key. That design is called Baki, is how you pronounce that. Actually, now people call it Bakips. So it stands for before, after, controlled, impact. You can talk to me if you want to know about more about that. But it's a way of controlling for natural variation and properly measuring the environmental effect of a perturbation. Typically some kind of pollution event. So we were able to set up the ideal kind of, in many cases, the ideal kind of monitoring in places like the intertidal, in at least some of the intertidal, which is a great advance. So we had quantitative data, and we could quantitatively say what's going on. The other advance, we established the trustee council. This is a group of interested parties. And there's representatives from the state, from the tribal governments, all that kind of stuff. And those guys decide, how to progress with the studies and the mitigation and this and that. Key to this, the trustee council decided to fund research. And I'm not just saying this, I'm a scientist that likes to do research. But they funded research, but they did so at a holistic level. They were very much so taking the ecosystem perspective, not a reductionist perspective, not the physicist perspective, not the molecular biologist perspective, but rather the ecosystem perspective. Without this, and also they funded long-term studies, without those things, we would not have understood, for example, right now that the herring population, 20 years after the Exxon spill, has not recovered exactly because of the Exxon spill. If we didn't have that, we'd just say, oh, I don't know, maybe the herring were having a bad day, or maybe some other climate change or whatever. No. We know that certain perturbations are a direct consequence now of that. Because we understand how energy moves through the system, because we understand these trophic relationships among different critters, really key. Okay. Oh, again, so then that sets up OPA 90. So the Exxon spill is the last of the old way that we handle oil spills. The old way we handle oil spills is this. Oil spills, government guys, go fix it. At the end of your attempt to fix it, then you give the oil company a bill. Now it's changed. In the wake of OPA 90, we now have what we refer to as the responsible party, which would be the shipping company, the oil company, whoever it is. And that responsible party has to clean up their own mess. The government will be there looking over their shoulder, right? If they don't like what's going on, they will do something different. But the idea is, instead of the government being responsible, the responsible party is responsible. One. Two, another big difference, when this happened and we killed all these sea otters, what happened? Gave a bunch of money to a bunch of economists and said, hey, economists, how much is a sea otter worth? And they essentially did what we saw earlier with regards to the black sea bass. They basically said, oh, let me do some things. And how much would you pay for a sea otter? And how much money do people pay to go to the Monterey Bay Aquarium and see the, you know, all that kind of stuff? And they come up with some number, who knows, $5,000 per sea otter. And they go, okay. And they'd ask somebody like me, okay, how many dead sea otters did you get? And say, I don't know, I got 100 dead sea otters. Oh, you got 100 dead sea otters? Okay, well, sea otters were the $5,000 and there's 100 dead of them. So therefore, you company have to pay, you know, $500,000. Or wait, no. Yeah. You guys get the point, right? And then they write the check and it's good. After the Exxon spill, the responsible party does not have to quantify the dollar value of those sea otters. If we decided, oh, we killed 100 sea otters, the answer is you have to make 100 sea otters, company. You can do it in any way that you see fit. I mean, it has to be approved by, you know, government agencies and stuff, depending on if it's an endangered species or something. But basically, you could make, how can we make 100 sea otters? We can make 100 sea otters, I don't know, by shooting a bunch of sharks, if there's sharks in the area, so that we increase the survivorship of baby sea otters. That would count. Maybe we have to set up a nursery and have moms give birth and help those babies and outplant those babies. Maybe one of those things costs 1,000 times more than another thing. We don't care. After OPA 90, they have to replace the resource. Doesn't matter what the cost is. They can figure out the most efficient cost, but we got rid of all this insanity of trying to spend, you know, years and years. How much does a sea otter cost, right? It's like, no, forget that. It's just you have to replace what's lost. Now, we still battle. We still have discussions, and the discussions are, how much of the resource was impacted. So now the amount of the resource impacted becomes even more critical than it was before. Okay, before we talk about let's talk a little bit about the Gulf Coast, since you guys haven't been there. So this big giant Caribbean basin is this big bowl with a broken lip on the right-hand side. Climate is really, really important to dictating what goes on in this relatively small water body compared to something like the Pacific. Especially when we get near the coastal areas, river discharge is incredibly important. River discharge and the change in amount of water coming out of a given river system has a strong influence on water dynamics, water movement, all that stuff. Wind, turns out wind also is really important. And it can have a strong effect, again, on how the water masses are moving around, etc. In general, the weather goes like this. In winter, we have cold air outbreaks. We do have frost, for example, in some of our garden sites in Louisiana. We do have frost, so it can get actually surprisingly cold there. In the spring, we have this rapid warming. And then the summer goes to a period which often is relatively still, and then it's pierced by these wind events, or these windy phenomena that come in. But generally, pretty stratified water, and then the fall is when we see this really rapid ocean mixing, and the deeper waters come shallow and lead to the cooling. Also important in this area of the world are tropical storms and hurricanes. Obviously, Hurricane Katrina is the most famous recent example. Here's some of the ecosystems that we have there that may not be as familiar to us here in California. One, we have what I call the coastal fringe. And so this is this area that's bleeding. It's a very flat, it's a very pancakey type of coast. It's not like our California coast. So we have seagrasses to sort of sandy beach, dune complexes into wetlands and back areas. So if we talk about the coastal wetlands in the area proximate to where the Deepwater Horizon happened, the coastal area of Louisiana, let's say, is really this vast dissolving Swiss cheesing landscape. It's disappearing every day right before our eyes because of our poor management practices that we're engaged with. And it's created, therefore, this very complex coastline that of this eroding and lowered elevation marsh and all these different things. Seagrass beds, we have seagrass beds here, of course, but nowhere like the distribution in the Gulf Coast or the East Coast, because again, they're these very flat, broad stretch areas. We're very much the up-down coast. We don't have a whole lot of area, potential area for seagrass. They have massive amounts of area. These are very productive areas, especially classically nursery grounds for invertebrates and fish, particularly for a lot of the kinds of invertebrates and fish that we like to eat, blue crabs and drum and things like that. And this, I'm just showing you, the most extensive beds are in Florida. We also have a huge abundance of artificial reefs associated with the oil and gas extraction that's gone on there for decades. So here's some red drum spawning. This is relatively shallow. This is some video from some folks in Alabama. And pretty cool. So we have the pelagic waters, a bit different than our pelagic waters. They tend to be less clear. A lot of sediments in the water, many more sediments than we have on average here on the West Coast. These cool fish swimming around. We have things like sargassum communities. We have sargassum species, a species of macroalgae, brown algae. These guys are, this is a different sargassum. This is the floating sargassum of the Sargasso Sea fame. So normally when thalli break off, we think of that as wrack, W-R-A-C-K. If something's gonna wash up on the beach and whatever. These guys, these plants are actually not dead per se, or not in the process of dying. They actually spend a significant amount of their life just floating, detached, not attached to anything, and forming these clumps, which are really, really important for whole ecosystems that grow up around these things, that use these things like a fish aggregating device. So little baby things, slightly larger things, and the bigger things that eat the little things, and on and on and on. So this, which might look like oil to you, an oil spill, an oil clump, is actually a sargassum pile. So behaves almost exactly like an oil slick, right? Floats on the surface, kind of sticks together, and moves around. So a particularly vulnerable community when we have something like a surface oil spill. And then, unlike most of our area here in California, the bottom is dominated by muddy, soft bottoms and particularly muddy habitats. And so these are some examples of some of the reefs. We probably wouldn't call them reefs here. These are very low relief structures, very far off the bottom, generally not rocky. So here's another video. We're looking down now at this area that's maybe a meter, 2-3 meters off the bottom at most. So nowhere near as structurally complex as our reefs, but still incredibly important. So check it out. Look at all the stuff growing on these outcrops, fish associated with them. So the reefs that they have there tend to be sparse and low relief, but they're nevertheless important. Super low relief. Okay. So there you go. All right. Now we've set everything up. Let's now go to the Deepwater Horizon. What happened with that situation? So Deepwater Horizon is from the Macondo Prospect. How it works is our government, these are your resources. This oil in the ground is your resource. The government, through at the time what was called the Minerals Management Service, it's now been broken up into two daughter agencies. But at the time, the Minerals Management Service, which was part of the Department of Interior, the West Coast office of which is about a 5-minute drive from campus here in Camarillo. So those guys decide, oh my God, there's some oil here, so we're gonna lease this out. So they create blocks. They say, here's the right to drill in this block. Who wants to bid on it? And they have a bidding process, a closed bidding process. And all of you companies put in your bid. And if you have the highest bid, you win the opportunity to drill that oil. You don't win the oil, you win the opportunity to drill for oil. Maybe there's a ton of oil there, maybe there's zero oil there, you pay the same amount regardless, right? So the oil companies are expert in looking at this stuff, looking at the geological structure, and saying, okay, I think it's probably got X many barrels of oil, and we at the price we're thinking the oil is gonna be like for the next few years, okay, this, we're gonna bid that amount. So the Macondo Prospect is where the oil spill is going to happen. We often hear the term BP. It's actually a BP-led consortium. So BP is the largest. So it used to be back in the day with the Santa Barbara oil spill. It used to be a company bids on a lease, puts their platform on, drills their oil, puts it on their ships or pipeline, and takes it to their refinery or maybe somebody else's refinery, right? That is not how the industry is now. It's completely exploded, and everything is subcontractors. Even with this drilling, most drilling operations, it's not an individual, it's a consortium. It's a group of related companies. So that's the case here. So it's BP-led. BP controlled 65% of the project, but it wasn't just BP. And so they bid on this and they leased this parcel of the seafloor and the underlying resources from you, the people of America, in 2008. In particular, this is one subsection, one grid called Mississippi Block 252. And as the crow flies, it was 70 kilometers from the coastline of Louisiana, from Plaquemines Parish, where we work, and was at a depth of almost exactly 1,500 meters. So this is deep. Right? That's a kilometer and a half straight down just to get to the bottom of the ocean. And then they drill deep into the ground after that. The attraction here is that this oil is light, sweet crude. Light, meaning it's more like kerosene or jet fuel or gasoline, the lighter fraction. Sweet, meaning it doesn't have much sulfur. So we like sulfur-free hydrocarbons. It makes it easier to process. You don't have as much hydrogen sulfide kind of toxic gas that comes off when you do the processing, but also it means that if you burn it, you don't have as much sulfur, so you're not generating as much sulfur oxides and things. So everybody always prefers for environmental reasons, for cracking reasons, for refining reasons, everybody prefers sweet relative to sour. If you have a lot of sulfur, it's called sour oil. Okay, now to do this, BP uses Transocean, another company, a Houston-based company with a vessel that's flagged in the Marshall Islands. So an example of flags of convenience. You guys will remember this from your William Languishy chapters. He talks extensively about that. So this is an example of a flag of convenience. So Transocean's Deepwater Horizon Marshall Islands flag. This particular vessel, this is a mobile drilling platform. It was launched in 2001. So it's relatively new. It's new tech. It's not something that's from 50 years ago. BP leased it on a 5-year lease. And it had the record at the time of the deepest drilling of oil anywhere in the world. So it was designed to operate in water that was almost 2.5 kilometers deep to the bottom. And then after you get to the bottom there, to drill more than 9,000, more than 9 kilometers straight into the earth. This is crazy technology. I cannot emphasize this enough. This is, if you're an engineer, this is awesome. This is like SpaceX, literally. I mean, the complexity of the control systems, the incredible challenges that these engineers have to overcome, this is really, really hard stuff. So these are fantastically technologically competent folks that work in this deep sea drilling world. And again, the Deepwater Horizon ship itself, the drilling platform, set the world record in 2009 at 10,683 meters below the surface of the bottom of the ocean. That is crazy. That's amazing. Okay, what happened was we drilled, found oil, great. This is a floating platform. The idea is we cap the well, we put a seal on it, turn everything off, and then float the drilling platform away and bring in a permanent production platform. Put that guy in place, reconnect the well, unplug the well, and then get the oil out. That's the process. So they're getting ready to do this. In the process of getting ready to do this, we have a capping event. How the capping works, I mentioned before, we put some drill mud. We essentially plug the straw with some heavy stuff, some heavy muds, clays. And then we put a cement plug in there, and then some other stuff. And we basically plug it up so the pressure won't allow that material. It's literally just like we had a can of soda. And it should get the soda, right? That pressure wants to push the soda out of the top of the bottle. So the idea is to jam something in the neck of the bottle to keep it contained. Unfortunately, as we know now, that part failed. So they were in the process of doing that. They thought they were just about done. When something clearly seemed to be wrong. Now, I should say that I haven't seen the new movie. Have you guys seen that movie that came out? Something like that, the Mark Wahlberg spill or something. So I haven't seen it. I'm sure it's all Hollywoodized and stuff. But what happened here was people were having safety concerns before this thing happened. This is, I used to know off the top of my head, I haven't given this lecture in a while, I can't remember. I want to say it was something on the order of about $1 million a day to operate this platform. Just in the operations, not the drilling, just to keep it going. Very expensive. So having this guy sit around for another few weeks, another month or two, is going to be a large amount of money. So it was pretty clear that there was a lot of pressure to let's go. Let's get this guy done. Right. Let's move on. They don't let the cement cap. There's a bunch of problems. Problems with stuff in the well bore itself. The problems go on and on. Long story short, we get a methane kick, which is a burp of methane that comes up at night on April 20th, and it burps up, and it goes around the casing, and it starts emitting methane. How these drilling platforms work is once they get to this stage, they use the natural gas, the stuff that's coming out of the wellhead, they use that in their generators, right? So they have their own gas supply. Gas burps up, and people first recognize it they see this weird thing in the pressure gauge, but then the pressure starts getting really high and they can't figure it out. And then this gas, this essentially fuel, natural gas, comes out and gets sucked into the generators. And the generators, instead of burning gas and air, are burning gas and air and gas. And they go, they peg, the lights blow out, right? It's like all of a sudden we jam the 110 volt, the 110 circuits to, you know, 300, right? And everything blows out, and then boom, and then this huge fireball explodes. Unclear what exactly starts. It's some spark somewhere in the deck. And then boom. 11 people die. 7 people are really badly hurt. And then the whole rig starts to catch on fire. And if you want to see some freaky stuff, you should watch the 60 Minutes interview with these guys the week after. It is crazy. These guys are jumping off of this. I mean, maybe that movie shows this, but these guys are jumping off this platform in pitch darkness. Have no idea how far the ocean is. Is it 30 feet down? Is it 70 feet down? Whatever. I mean, it is crazy time. And so that happens. We think, oh my gosh, that was horrible. You know, something bad happened, whatever. We don't see the first slick until the 22nd of April. The Obama administration is saying, oh, whoo, crisis averted, super glad. You know, sorry we only had 11 people die. I mean, we're sad we had 11 people die, but, you know, we got it under control. Don't freak out. It's a huge accident, but we got it contained. Then by April 23rd is the last day they're saying that. On this date, they suspend the search and rescue efforts for the missing folks presumed dead. Now the rig is burned, and the rig has essentially burned to a crisp and has fallen down to the bottom. It settles down to the bottom about 400 meters from the point where the well goes into the ground. So we have this snake of pipe along the ground. Still, mostly what we're seeing is sheen. Mostly what we're seeing is oil that, you know, from the whatever bilge and this and that, right? So what you'd typically expect if any old ship went crashed in the water. Homeland Security runs this risk analysis, and they claim on the 23rd of April, this incident, quote, poses a negligible risk to regional oil supply markets and will not cause significant national economic impacts. Don't! Not exactly. And then the White House press secretary has this unfortunate quote again the same day. I don't honestly think it opens up a whole new series of questions because, you know, in all honesty, I doubt this is the first accident that has happened, and I doubt it will be the last. Then we enter this nonstop flow of oil. And what I start hearing from my neighbors, from all these people is, well, that was horrible, but, you know, accidents happen. You know what I'm saying? It's going to happen. You know, this is bad. We're really sorry it's happened. This is totally unfortunate. Let's fix it. But, you know, accidents just happen. That's the mantra you start hearing. That is untrue. That is an incorrect retelling of the facts. Now, I know we're about to enter a period where facts don't apparently matter so much, but the facts were not that. That is a misinterpretation. So if we look at what BP, the company BP, the British company, it used to be called BP because it was called British Petroleum. That's where the B and the P comes from. From 2000 to 2007, they try to rebrand themselves. They have a leader that wants to do something different, and they want to become an energy company. So they change the name of their company to Beyond Petroleum. They're investing in solar. They're doing all the stuff. They're not getting out of the oil business, but they want to be an energy company, regardless of the supply of that energy, supposedly. That lasts till 2007. The new head comes on in and goes, no. We're an oil company. Let's get rid of all the other stuff. So that lasts until 2007. From June of 2007 to February of 2010, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, which manages safety violations in industrial contexts in the U.S., had 761, quote, egregious and willful violations across the refineries in the U.S. At the time, there were 145. 760 of those violations came from BP operations. Now, partly that's because BP was buying more and more refineries, and so they were having a larger share, but that does not explain it. BP did not own 99.9% of all the refineries. It's now well understood that BP had a policy called run to failure. You guys have a car. You guys got to change the oil every, whatever, 5,000 miles, right? Go and you drive it for a while, then you take the oil out, put new oil in, make sure it's maintained. That's not how BP ran many of its operations. What BP would do was run the car until the car broke down and then put a new engine in it. So this is most clearly documented in their Alaska operations, where they will run it, and it would run stuff until on pipelines and stuff until the motors just, the bearings ground and just they have failed. So they determined in their fiscal analysis that that was a better policy than a maintenance policy. A maintenance policy, a robust maintenance policy, was costing them more, and they were really under pressure to produce for shareholders. And there's been all kinds of stories, but it started with ProPublica's investigation in 2010 in the wake of the Deepwater Horizon. For example, but one example, the Texas City Refinery in Texas in 2005 had a massive, this is a massive refinery, huge explosion, killed 15 people, injured 180 people, because they didn't want to replace a part that was worth about $100,000 that they needed to. And they were essentially letting it run to failure. Because of that egregious violation, they were fined $370, at the time that it was one of the largest, if not the largest, I can't remember, fine $370 million for that accident. 4 years later, they do another inspection, they find they didn't fix the problem. 4 years later. So they get fined again, $87.4 million. So this is not, just accidents happen. This is Julian Assange, who's entered the presidential debate and facilitated leaking documents and things like that. So this guy has clearly has some kind of agenda with WikiLeaks. But one of the things that we learned about how BP operates was from the initial dump of documents from WikiLeaks. So WikiLeaks, these guys, Bradley Manning steals all these top secret documents and basically lets them go. All these top secret documents relate to a bunch of stuff. One of the documents he releases has to do with this gas field in the Caspian Sea. So this is Azerbaijan. And they get about 95% of their gross domestic product is sales receipts from natural gas. So to full disclosure, our NGO in Turkey, this pipeline. So basically, you guys won't remember this history, but so Russia and Europe have been having bad relations lately. One of the things that Russia did in this lead up to this was to want more money from, basically the Europeans didn't like what Russia was doing, so Russia got ticked, so Russia said that they have to service their gas pipelines, so started turning off natural gas to especially Eastern Europe and in the wintertime. So people started getting super cold, gas prices skyrocketed, and Russia said, oh, sorry. So in response to that, there was a huge push in the mid late 2000s to get another source of gas that could go, natural gas that could go to Europe. So this is this gas pipeline, the BTC pipeline that goes through some of our areas and sites in Turkey. And that's to bring natural gas from the Caspian Sea through Turkey to Europe. So an alternative source of natural gas for Europe. So this was gonna happen, this was a big thing. Many of the many of the companies here that are operating are American oil companies, and all of a sudden something goes wrong. In 2008, everything gets shut down, and nobody can figure out what's going on. So the government of Azerbaijan gets ticked off, and they call the American embassy, and they say, "Hey, American embassy, what the heck's going on? We need to make money. We need this gas flowing." And the embassy can't figure out, so the embassy sends a representative, and he goes and susses this out. And all we heard in the news was there's blowout, everything's okay. This isn't a very difficult part of the world to get to. There's a lot of crazy things happening in this part of the world. So not a lot of reporters. So in the mass media, there's some notes about it, but it was kind of glossed over. We didn't find out what was going on until this document was leaked. And this document was the memo from the representative from the embassy that was investigated. So what we now know happened was, if this sounds familiar, failed cementing of the well bore. Okay. In this case, they had they actually took the warnings to heart and they evacuated everyone before the platform blew up. BP was doing that, and Halliburton was involved too, same entities. So, so what we find amazingly is that BP's partners, their consortium partners, are PO'd. Chevron is PO'd. BP won't talk to Chevron. Chevron's like, what the heck's going on? And so the common theme here is BP, no information, and they're controlling the show. Failed cementing of the wellbore. Same thing that happens in Deepwater Horizon. So jumping back to Deepwater Horizon. So this stuff is happening. Oh my God, let's shut it off. We have what's called a blowout preventer. We have a what looks like a big refrigerator that sits over the pipe at the bottom of the ocean. And it's got this giant pair of metal pinchers. So just like if you wanted to crimp a pipe, you want to squeeze it, and then that would staunch the flow. That's what these things do. So what you saw for the first few days is you saw a video like this. They were of remotely operated vehicles, robots going down and flicking the switch that says pinch, and nothing would happen. And just like you, when your battery dies in your remote, and you're pushing like, change the channel. You probably should get up after the third time and go and physically change the channel. But if you're like me, you try for another minute. Like, well, no, if I push it like the 17th time, it'll work. That's what we were doing here. Chick, chick, nope, didn't work. Try it again. Chick, chick, no, didn't work. Bang it, bang, bang. Try it again. Chick, chick, no, didn't work. Not all of the investigative documents have been released, but what's pretty clear, it seems, this guy didn't work for a variety of reasons. One, we had two pieces of pipe that were together, right? You join pipe, and they put the part where the two pipes join together, so it's doubly thick, right where the scissors is. So that was bad to start with. Two, they never checked the battery. They never serviced the battery that moves the servos to do it. So it probably could never have gone off, even under the most ideal conditions. So bad implementation, bad safety oversight, bad maintenance, all comes together and gave us the point where the fallback procedure, the safety valve, couldn't be turned on or couldn't be turned off. So that's called the blowout preventer. And then we start to see, importantly for us in coastal marine management, we start to see the seeds of distrust really start to get sown. This is, let me orient you guys to this. This is spill day from day zero to on into the summer, okay? On this y-axis is the oil flow rate. So how much oil is coming out per hour or per day? The estimates change over time. And I'm showing most of them as a bar because it was a range. People are saying, oh, it's between X and Y. Everybody with me on this? The star is what they put in their environmental impact document that they had to put in to get permitted to do the drilling in the first place. So they said, the worst case scenario is we could have flows. If something goes wrong, we have oil flowing out of the bottom of the ocean. Could be flowing at that rate. Okay. Once the oil starts flowing, this number down here, really close to the x-axis, which was an estimate of 5,000 barrels a day, that's the first number that comes out. How do you think we know how much those first estimates, where do you think that data comes from? Any guesses? Seattle, because Seattle's super close to Louisiana. So there's a spill group, a great group, NOAA group in Seattle that does these estimates. So normally we have a ship crash, oil gets leaked, whoo, there's oil all over these guys, and they have some pretty well-calibrated estimates for the amount of sheen, how much oil is on the surface, they take pictures and how much is that slick and everything, then they can estimate what volume of oil generated that slick. So they were going off photographs of oil on the surface of the ocean near the site of the platform, and that's where these first numbers are coming from. No measurements, no looking at video, no nothing. Over time, you see that these estimates are like, that's a little low, let's go a little bit higher. No, it's a little bit higher. So it goes higher, 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 until we finally get our so-called flow rate technical group. Okay, I already said that. So this is the permit, so that's the worst case scenario. This bar is with the National Incident Command setup. Haven't talked to you guys about that yet. So the next thing, we have OPA 90. What was OPA 90? Oil Pollution Act of 1990, and that was what was created in the wake of the Exxon spill. The other thing we haven't mentioned that I need to mention, what else happened 9 years before Deepwater Horizon? 9/11. World changed. One of the things we did was revamp and overhaul what's called the National Incident Command System. So that is the way that the government will deal with a disaster. Wildfire, earthquake, terrorist attack, whatever. And it determines who's the lead agency, who's the top responsible party. The top federal manager, the top agency, what other agencies are involved, etc. And it sets up a way to, who has authority, how does information flow, all that kind of stuff. In the case of a marine oil spill, what agency is in charge, Greg?
U.S. Coast Guard.
Coast Guard. Okay, so it's going to depend on the accident. It's going to depend on the situation as to who's in charge. In this case, Coast Guard is the lead federal agency. So the NIC stands for the National Incident Command. Okay, so that's the guys running the show. They report this to be the worst case scenario. They give a range. So their estimates are significantly lower than in the documents what the company originally reported years previously when they were seeking their permits. So that's important. This starts flowing, oil's flowing, and people like me and other people are saying, this looks like a lot more than 5,000 gallons or whatever the estimate is. So what happens is a reporter from NPR takes a videotape, low-res videotape, not HD, but low-res videotape, to an expert in fluid dynamics, shows it to him, says, can you take a look at this? And just does a quick back of the envelope, puts it on his computer, and goes, that's a lot more than the volume that is being reported. So then they write they do some news stories, and that starts this whole investigation. And then pretty soon, this group of experts comes together, and they're called the Flow Rate Technical Group. So they're mostly academic scientists, some USGS, some government scientists. And basically, all they did was get locked away and get access to the HD video, which is what BP had access to, and use that and use their calculations they use when they're trying to calculate how much flow is happening in water, and they start coming up with much better estimates. You would think someone would maybe go down and put a propeller in the stream of flowing oil and get an actual estimate, but we didn't do that. So the Flow Rate Technical Group produces the best estimate. And then a little bit later on, that farther right is an independent group in science publishes a estimate, which is very, very similar to the Flow Rate Technical Group's estimate. This is sped up, so you guys get this really quickly, but I'll just show you guys this is what happened. So here's the surface oil slick progressing through so we have oil coming to the surface, and then some of it's dolloping. When it hits the coast and it causes significant oiling, that causes the red dot. So if the beach is significantly oiled or the marsh, that's what that is. So you've seen over time, surface oil, tagging. So problematic, but not as bad as people like me were originally saying, oh my God, the wetlands are all gonna be dead. Wetlands are gonna be dead. Significant oiling, to be sure, lots of red dots, but not every single spot. Not every single spot has a red dot. Oil hasn't gotten every single spot, but a lot of oil. This is the largest deployment a coordinated deployment of vessels on the surface of the ocean since World War II, since D-Day. Massive amount of vessels. These are both Coast Guard vessels and industry vessels, but also so-called vessels of opportunity, which are fishermen that have essentially been trained to deploy boom and various and skimming technologies and going out. So this is 5,000 vessels. This is an insanely complex, separate from all the oil and the cleanup, just orchestrating 5,000 vessels. That's a very, very challenging thing. And so after several days of trying all this stuff, all these various things, we try top hat and junk shot and all these things, nothing works. Finally, what we decide is we bring in the Deepwater Horizon's sister ship to drill another well. So it's going to drill down, go below where we think the break is, the fracture is, go down, drill in, and then essentially squirt in drill mud and cement and plug the well that way. This spill is characterized by this inordinate fondness for the skin and the shore. That was me. That was my problem. That was my hang up. That was me and many other people sending us astray. So the part of our coastal and marine resources that are easy to see get a disproportionate amount of attention. Here's that oiled seabird. Saw very few seabirds oiled, very few. Definitely critters were killed. Nothing like what we originally thought we'd see. Sea turtle eggs, right? Over there, I see some rescuers getting ready to dig up some sea turtle eggs and move around. Here's President Obama, has to come to the shore, has to kick the sand, look like he's doing something, right? Same thing as Nixon, same story as 1969. Same thing we'll see with the Refugio spill, same thing. Other scientists like me further the problem by, again, these guys are trying to help out. So this is from the National Center for Atmospheric Research. These guys in Colorado. And they use this circulation model. So they say, hey, if this oil comes out, what might happen? Here's a model of what they think might happen. There's a current that moves around in the Gulf called the loop current. So they're modeling that. This is a theoretical liquid on the surface of the ocean. What? So on day 42, they released this model, trying to help out. All of a sudden, Washington starts paying a lot more attention. You mean this oil might come up to Washington, D.C.? This oil from those poor rednecks in Louisiana might come up the eastern seaboard? What? Oh, a new flurry of attention, a new flurry of worry. Everybody starts freaking out. This is only talking about the surface of the ocean, a surface slick. But it really galvanized attention. At this point, we were screwed. That's a technical term. At this point, once the oil started flowing, we had very poor options. Very poor options. So I'm going from, and whenever we have these, just like so many of the other things we have in coastal marine management, it's a trade-off. We do this action, we block this other action. Everybody with me? Yeah? Okay. So first is we can cap the well. We can just stop it. That's the ideal thing. That's the best thing, right? Stop the oil, boom. But barring that, and we couldn't do that. We kept trying. We couldn't do it. So then as we go down towards the bottom of this slide, we get to options that are more and more problematic, right? More and more downsides. So the first one is capture the oil. You can capture that in a variety of ways. We can vacuum it. We can put it into containers, something like that. We can do physical separations. So Kevin Costner was, making this salad spinner type thing that they'd invented, this cyclone spinner to separate oil from water. This one company, which was really amazing, actually took a oil tanker and cut holes in it, like a baleen whale. And the idea was to try to skim oil. There's all these things people were trying. And again, it's hard to explain how people had no idea when this was going to stop. They had no idea it was going to stop next week or go for a year, right? So this was, you got to put yourselves in this mindset of unprecedented spill. Nothing like this was the deepest by far oil spill ever. and people just could not shut it down. So all these things. Also possibly restrict the movement of the oil to make it easier to catch with booms or something like that. The other thing we could do, and then more and more trade-offs we go down, we can transform the oil. So maybe we don't pick the oil out of the ocean, but maybe we put it into a form that's less toxic. We could do that by catching it on fire or combustion. We could do that by having microbes eat it up, right? We could do that by using dispersants to make it be less blob-like, maybe more diffuse, and then more available to physical breakdown and to microbial breakdown. Or lastly, which is the worst option, which nobody wants to do, is just simply give up and go home and wait for it to stop itself. All of these things are hard. So the combustion is problematic. That's what I'm showing you in the background picture here. So that's a case where we've boomed off a section of oil, and these guys have gotten that oil started. For scale, look over here on the left. Here's an 8-man Zodiac. That's nothing. That's almost nothing. So we burned oil, but it was a small fraction of the total amount. The problem with burning is it's really hard to catch oil on fire. Maybe you think, no, but on the surface of the ocean, it's actually hard to catch it on fire. Two, you have to have the most primo conditions. It has to be super flat so you can concentrate it, build it up, can't be windy, all this and that. Also, we now have evidence that the oil that we burned up drops soot throughout the South, especially in Atlanta, Georgia. So we've turned an ocean pollutant into an air pollutant, and now it's affecting air quality as far away as Atlanta, Georgia. So all these things have trade-offs, right? Nothing is perfect. This is what the oil looked like. So you see these ribbons? This is weathered oil. This rust-colored stuff is oil. You see it like this a lot in these furrows, these windrows. You sometimes see it in thicker concentrations like this. Very few pictures of animals in the oil. One of my friends who was tagging whales at the time sent me or let me use this photo. This is a flying fish going through a light sheen. Didn't see a lot of oiled critters. Lots of unintended consequences. Here are some of those. So in the upper left here, this is an oiled marsh. It's been oiled, the vegetation has been harmed, but it's not all dead necessarily. The subsurface rhizomes are still there. But so that in this case, this is a friend of mine's experiment where he's looking to look at recovery of the system. Then a lot of, let's do something. I won't put this on the podcast because you guys can ask me the story. I told some of you guys a story, but we'll talk about it in Louisiana if you guys come with me. But there's a whole backstory to this that we won't go into today. Suffice it to say, contractors were stationed all around to clean up the beaches, to clean up the wetlands. They were not paid unless they cleaned. So there was an incentive for these guys to go dig up the beach and other things. Because if they did, they got paid something, depending on the conditions, but something like $25,000 a day. If they didn't clean anything, they didn't get paid anything. And they're paying all their staff, they're paying all their guys. So there's some perverse incentives actually going on here. So as a consequence, let's go dig up this beach. Look at these guys digging up that beach. Is that really, not really what we need to be doing? But that's what we're doing. All this activity on the beach did things like some of our endangered shorebirds got whacked. There's roadkill, which I am always very interested in. Roadkill on the beach from an ATV driving over the beach. Now, were those guys trying to kill that bird? Of course not. But it's a knock-on effect of some of this response. Everybody, oh my God, the big spill. The talk was, this was Obama's Katrina. Right? Love to use that phrase. Everybody, I think just like we have the word gate, Watergate, now everything is something gate. I think we're going to be locked into whoever the leader is, blah, blah, blahs, Katrina, because of the problems President Bush experienced during the mismanagement and attempted recovery in the wake of that thing. But, crude awakening, all this stuff, right? Everybody's screaming, we got to do something, got to do something. People think dispersants are saving us. So again, what we can do, we're going to throw these dispersants, these detergents on the surface of the ocean, and that'll break up the oil, and that'll be great. And so this is, some of the political commentary at the time. This is what dispersants do. So here we have some oil, right? There's some oil on water, and then we're going to add some dispersant here. Boom, right? So oil is hydrophobic. It's afraid of the water, so it makes this clump of oil. The dispersants break that down and allow it, and essentially allow those little molecules of oil to not have to touch, to not have to be Velcroed to one another. Now, I better turn this down. This is what dispersants look like when we're applying them from planes. These are firefighting airplanes that normally drop fire retardant. So these guys are bombing essentially this oil slick with detergent. So they go and they target these areas, drop it on it. If you look, that stuff is already weathered. Dispersants work best on crude oil. Should we use dispersants? Is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? We don't have good data on the toxicity of these dispersants, I would argue to you. So we don't know how bad these things are. Primarily, we've worried about them and about with things like model organisms. So we typically have used our so-called bioassays. So using typically what's called LC50s, lethal concentration at which 50% of the target critters die. For those, we primarily use that shrimp on the right and that fish on the right. So these are common estuary critters that we would see in a typical salt marsh. And the studies at the time we started applying these dispersants, that's what they used. And so we had said this amount of dispersant is okay and that amount is not okay, etc. But nobody had done this experiment with Makonda oil, and people hadn't done it in a complex way, and we were starting to use dispersants more and more and more. So the then head of the EPA said, Lisa Jackson said, hey, hold on a second, let's do some studies. So the feds paused the use of dispersants and then started to do a little bit of investigation. They should be given a massive amount of credit. They did a huge amount of work in a very short amount of time, and after a couple days determined what they thought meant that the dispersants were okay, and given the risk from the oil, let's go ahead and use them, so they green-lighted it. So they tried to do their due diligence in a chaotic situation. The reality is we should have done that before we were in the crisis mode, but still. This is what they did. This is how that works. You take some oil, and some of you guys might be doing this for your capstone. We basically take oil, mix it up in clean seawater, and so we start on the left with regular oil, and then it's spinning around, and then we add the dispersant, and on the lower right you see dispersed oil, right? So that oil that was all mostly contained in this vortex now it's all a bunch of little small oil droplets, and on the right here is a picture of oil with different types of dispersants. There's a variety to choose from. Don't have time to go into all that today. But suffice it to say, this is the shrimp toxicity. This is the fish toxicity. And long story short, here's Corexit. There's a bunch of products we don't care about right now. Here's Corexit. Here's oil. And this is how toxic the oil is. You guys getting me? So we take the oil, water with oil in it, expose it to these critters, see how frequently they die. Then we take dispersed oil, right, and do that. In this case, this is Corexit. This is what we did. This was how they originally started. This is Corexit alone. You guys got it? So they did this and they said, hey, Corexit is about as toxic as the oil, right? So that means it's no worse than the oil, but it might actually help the oil break down more, right? So therefore, let's go ahead and use Corexit. And Corexit is just the brand name of the dispersant. And also, in complete So I mentioned that my NGO has benefited from indirectly from BP money through that pipeline. Also, I need to say the company that makes Corexit paid for me to travel to a conference and talk about our work. So I wasn't speaking for the company, but they did pay for my travel one time. So just everything up above board. Now, in the application, the novel thing about this was the bombing of dispersants from airplanes. We'd done that before. We did that in the Ixtoc example, etc. The novel thing was, take this, we had this oil squirting out of the bottom of the ocean. Let's put the dispersants right down and squirt it right in there. Brilliant idea, awesome idea. Now, I don't think so much. But at the time, we didn't know, remember, chaotic. Hey, let's do it, it was cool. This is what it looked like. So this is a live feed that I recorded from BP's website at the time. So this, the brown stuff is oil. We have an ROV with an arm, and it's got a hose that's going up to the surface, 1,500 meters above it. And that white stuff is the dispersant. So essentially the ROV is holding this squirting detergent in the stream, in the flow stream of the oil, just as it's coming out of the broken wellhead at the bottom of the ocean. You know, so great idea. And if you look, the oil is darker at the bottom. It's a little bit creamer colored, lighter color at the top. So again, knowing we knew the time, totally let's do it. I think it was the right decision to make at the time. Knowing what I know now, maybe not. But knowing then, yeah. So this is what we did. Again, here's that graph again of time going from the start of the oil spill to the right. This is the flow rate, okay? So this is using the flow rate technical groups data. The yellow is what we think the flow rate is. It changes when stuff happens, like we cut off the pipe and do a few things. The flow rate decreases through time because we're lowering the pressure of the reserve. The green is the application rate of the dispersant. Have a look at this. This is unprecedented. We used up 1/3 of the Earth's supply of Corexit during this event. This is a massive, massive volume of dispersants we're putting in the ocean. Recall, they are as toxic as the oil, right? If not, more so when they're combined with oil. But that's another conversation. So what you're seeing here is the solid line is the stuff that's being applied from airplanes, Coast Guard airplanes, bombing the oil. The dotted line is the stuff that it took us, you know, a bit longer to figure that out, but this is the stuff from the ROVs, this is the stuff at the bottom squirted into the flow stream. And then at the far right there, we finally cap the wellhead, and that's when it shuts off. Okay. You guys okay? You guys are sounding like you're very quiet today. Am I depressing you or something? Okay, we'll finish this. We'll try to finish this quick. All right, so here we go. Now, so that all sounds good, getting control of the oil. Then we started noticing midway through something is weird. So here's some of the evidence that we noticed something is weird. This is from a screen grab from an ROV from Woods Hole, or this ROV that's down there. And look to the right, and that's what the light's on, okay? That's what the regular bright light's on. This is down in the ocean. Turn that light off, flick on a UV light, and all that stuff on the right is over there. There's a bunch of stuff in the water. That's kind of weird. What the heck's that? Next, when we found this report, as far as we could tell, there was five people had read this report when we found this, aside from the guys that wrote it. So this is a really interesting study by a gentleman from MIT and a gentleman from Hawaii, University of Hawaii. And what they did was they were funded by the Minerals Management Service years before to do a modeling exercise. What happens if we have a blowout at the bottom of the ocean in a deep water drilling event? Maybe we should figure that out. So they built this huge flume that was pressurized and all this and that to simulate what was going on, and they modeled everything. And this is some of the output. This is from the appendix of the report that I've cut out here. And what you're seeing is basically what the plume is going to do. And so we know from this study that a lot of the oil was never going to go to the surface of the ocean, regardless if we put any dispersant in the water or not. The debate is what fraction wouldn't, but this is what happened. Okay, so you guys ready? Also, at the time, we have a lot of politicians, such as the person that was just recently elected lieutenant governor, let's say Louisiana, right, Christmas, who would say things like, "We're not stupid. You guys think we're all stupid. We know what happens when you mix oil and water. We're not stupid," right? You mix oil and water, the oil floats to the surface. We got to do something. We got to do something, Obama. Do something, Obama. Do something, Governor. Do something, do something, do something. Everybody was convinced, as I was, but I wasn't bringing the political pressure, that this is what the story was. Here comes the oil. Oil's starting at the bottom of the ocean. There goes the oil. The oil's to the surface of the ocean. Ah! Get the oil off the surface of the ocean. Poor birdies. This is what really happened. At that depth and pressure, oil is not positively buoyant. This stuff was coming out of the ocean hot. It's hot underneath you in the geological structure. Hot. It's coming out. And it's going through this torn straw. It's like this. And so it's bubbling itself. It's breaking itself up. It's like it's going through a grate, right? So it's not coming out these big dollop as an oil seep might. It's getting homogenized, it's getting broken up, and it's not thick. So what's actually going on is methane. Methane, that this was mostly a methane spill. You didn't see that because CNN can't film methane. So the methane is what was lighter than the water. The methane is what was pulling it up. This oil is getting pulled up till it gets to a hydrological discontinuity, a density decline. And then it's fallen out. So the methane keeps going up, the oil remains. So from a management perspective, we're almost done, you guys. We're almost done. Pay attention here. So from a management perspective, this is what happened. Oh my God, look at all this oil. There's oil everywhere, but there's, you know, obviously there's places that are heavily hit, but by and large, most of the coast is okay. It wasn't the end of the world like all those wacky enviros were screaming. Right? Wasn't the end of the world. We definitely had birds and sea turtles impacted, but not a gazillion, bazillion sea turtles and birds. Right? Not like what we said, not like all the seabirds in the Gulf Coast are going to die, nothing like that. So the question became, after a few weeks, where was all this oil going? What was going on? And so what was put out was this thing, the oil spill calculator. Now, to be fair, this is what the Coast Guard uses to in their day-to-day planning operations. How much oil is there, how much we picked up, et cetera. This was not meant to be a research tool or device, but it's what the only thing we had at the time. And so what you find from here is, have a look at this, where's the oil? A lot of the oil is basically gone. So we burned 5% of it. We skimmed a small percentage and put it in boats, 3%. We dispersed, some of it. But, you know, most of it evaporated the atmosphere, was, you know, all this and that. Great. We took care of it all. We accounted for it all. On the right is a classic diagram that you saw in the newspapers. This is one variant of it. Right? That diagram, totally wrong. We have this evidence mounting for some type of subsurface plume. This is Imbari's Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute. You guys can ask me about how this got there in the first place, but it's long story short. This was in the Gulf, and they had to sit on the dock for a couple weeks because of bureaucratic stuff. But Anyway, this is an autonomous underwater vehicle. This is a vehicle we program, let it go, and it drives itself wherever. We can launch it from Monterey. It'll go down to San Diego, collect some samples, and come back to Monterey. See, it's awesome stuff. They drive this through, you know, near where the oil slick is, and they get this signal here, this blob thing on the left, that looks like there's something weird in the water column. Now, they don't have sensors that directly see oil. The sensors they use can be fooled by oxygen and other things, so they don't know this is positively oil at the time. But again, this evidence is mounting. There's something down there in the water. This is what happened. We took an incorrect paradigm. We took the paradigm I was used to and everybody else was used to. We took this paradigm, which was a shallow water spill or blowout. That would deposit some oil in the bottom of the ocean, most of which would go to the surface, form a surface slick, and then some would volatilize and the rest would go to the beach, right? The littoral coast, oil it. And all we did was do this. All those diagrams, newspaper, all they did was do this. Boom. Yep, that's what happened to Deepwater Horizon. That is not what happened to Deepwater Horizon. This is what we now know as is the reality. So the reality is we have all this deposition around the bottom of the wellhead, but then the vast majority of the oil is in this dispersed methane oil plume, and it's hanging out in there. And it's at about 1,200 meters to 1,400 meters down. It's chilling. We add dispersant to the surface. We add dispersant down here, and dispersant does something to the oil. But our group has some disagreements, but did it disperse the oil 10% more, 30% more, what? The point is, a large volume of oil, if we never put any dispersant down, would be in this exact spot because of the physics of the spill, of the blowout. That's what certain individuals from industry will not acknowledge. So we should be patting ourselves on the back because we're so smart. We put the dispersant down, and that's what saved the wetlands. I argue that the wetlands weren't endangered like I thought. What was endangered was the midwater. So we have all this oil here. Now we have the sea of oil. Oil's going on, so much so that we actually got evolution of the methanogens, of the microbes that eat methane. Normally, these guys have to scavenge. Methane is very rare in our environment. All of a sudden, it was crazy. They're like doing meth, right? They're out of control. There's so much methane that we see at least seven essentially different species, seven periods of evolution of these methanogens, and they change. And they become not efficient scavengers of methane. These are microbes, so they're turning over every couple days, right? So they actually lose the ability to be good methane scavengers. So they're like doobie-doo, they're like your uncle that is chilling, and then he comes over and he starts eating Doritos, and then you give him lots of bags of Doritos, and he becomes sloppy. He's eating Doritos go on his face, go on his belly, right? He's no longer an efficient Dorito eater. Then, about 80 days into the spill, we finally get the wellhead capped. And then we finally, overnight, turn off the oil supply and the methane supply. Overnight, your fat uncle, who's used to just pouring Doritos in his mouth, all of a sudden, the Doritos are gone. And this dude's like, a lot? Right? What am I doing? Right? And so all of a sudden, starts panicking. When you panic, you get worried. When a microbe panics, it starts to stress out. One of the things it does is do cellular exudates. It releases this mucus stuff when it starts getting stressed, when it starts getting energy stressed, and it can't get enough resource. So what starts to happen is this oil starts to get glued together by snot. So that's what we're seeing here. So we start to see this snot, and this is from our colleague Manny Joy at University of Georgia. So here is a core from the bottom of the ocean far away from the Deepwater Horizon. This is what you typically get. Core is sediment, and there's critters in here, and there's worms and stuff. Manny's done hundreds and hundreds of cores in the bottom of the Gulf of Mexico. Always has something. A a worm, a snail, a something. Started getting close to Deepwater Horizon, nothing macroscopic alive in it. Super weird. Started to get kind of close, you start to saw, see this film of oily snot on the surface. When you get closer, they'd see inches of this snot deposited in the bottom of the ocean. So we impacted the water column, and then we drew all that stuff out of the water column and dropped it on the bottom of the Gulf. So we started seeing things like this. This is a healthy Gorgonian in the bottom of the ocean with a brittle star in it. And then we started seeing stuff like this. Dead brittle star, dead Gorgonian. Crabs with, you guys are getting ready to go, but so don't go yet. Don't get, so crab with all this stuff. Okay, yeah. We saw impacts to the marsh. We saw die-offs like this. This is not a road, this is dead fish and snails. Back in the back marsh, near where we work in Louisiana. Never seen this of this magnitude, this location before. You could smell this from a half mile away. So looks just like ecosystem knock-on effects. We saw alligators with different parasite loads in their bellies in the oiled areas. So this water impact had a huge impact. Turtles are impacted, okay, everything, right, turtles, all this stuff. Fishery closures, we had to close down the fishery in the Gulf of Mexico. And, okay. So here we go. Have a look. Do not leave yet. We're almost done. I'm going to run you through a radar diagram. Littoral fringe, the coast, the bottom of the ocean, benthos, water column here. Okay? This is a one-axis graph. Different communities. Sandy beach, mudflat, marsh, oyster reef, water column. Shallow, the surface of the ocean, down to deeper in the water. The bottom of the ocean, starting off at seagrass bed, shallow, all the way down to deep in the bottom of the ocean, okay? I'm gonna symbolize this with a radar diagram. So everywhere you move out from the center increases, the volume increases, or the magnitude increases, okay? This is what our old paradigm was in terms of the farther away from the dot, the greater the impact. So we think in a traditional oil spill, surface spill, we think the marsh and the surface of the ocean would be the most impacted, right? Everybody with me on that? This is what we believe we saw. Now, some of this stuff is still caught up in NERDA documents, so we don't have all the data out yet, but this seems to be what happened. So, yes, it definitely hits the marsh a little bit and some mudflats, but really the main story was in the water column and down at the bottom of the ocean. Same graph, everybody with me? Same graph, I'm just gonna change the axes a little bit, okay? Same exact data. So here you go. The National Science Foundation needs to be given credit. They were the only group that funded rapidly scientists to get out there. This is a process where normally NSF takes months and months and months and months, get an application in, takes forever. This is rapid, quick. Turn it in a couple weeks, you get an answer back. I went through and looked at all the abstracts for what they funded. This is what they funded. Where their projects were. In the salt marsh. Again, because idiots like me told them to, right? Oh yeah, the salt marsh is gonna die. Better monitor the salt marsh before the oil comes in. That was wrong. That was bad guidance. NOAA has this natural resources damage assessment. They're charged with figuring out what the oil spill actually did, and we're still in that process. They were a little bit better. NOAA's studies that they funded weren't as focused on the marsh. They were still pretty marsh focused, but not as focused. But check out, they still missed all of this deep water stuff, at least initially. And then I went to the first, I gave a paper at the first oil spill conference about this, right? I just got an email today about, hey, you should come to the next one, which is in February. I went through all the abstracts of the talk and looked at what people were talking about. This is where they did their research. Marsh! Shallow surface water. If we have incorrect models of what the threat is to our coastal resource or any resource, we won't monitor correctly. If we don't monitor correctly, we won't know what happened. What was impacted? Jellyfish. Do people care about jellyfish? Right? When I talk to BP about jellyfish, they go, oh, you think we killed a lot of jellyfish? Yeah. Really? Yeah. Oh, so how many jellyfish did we have before the oil spill? Oh, well, I don't know because I wasn't there measuring. Oh, you weren't there measuring the jellyfish, huh? Well, we don't think we heard that many jellyfish. Prove it. right? If you don't have the data, you can't prove it. One thought, one last thought before you guys go, is using your ESRM skills to think about how the public perceive these resources and what the public care about, and maybe we should do something like this. This is not the Deepwater Horizon, but this is from a other spot. This is a ROV. These guys are looking at oil wellhead. They're like talking, hey, does that look good? Yeah. Hey, Jim, do you see that? You're like, what? So do you see that? I don't know what you're talking about. That thing right there. What thing right there? And he turns and he pulls back, and it's a sperm whale checking out the wellhead. People don't care about jellyfish. People care about the whales. This whale has to breathe. He has to go to the surface. He's going to be impacted if there's a surface slick. This whale feeds down in the midwater and deep, where we are arguing the impacts were greatest. So this is the example of a critter that would be a great candidate for looking at impacts, right? Its life cycle, its life history is involved with all these different areas, and it's something that CNN will cover. And it's something that all of our presidential candidates will understand when we talk about it. Okay? So that was a little bit about oil spills. So let me just finish up. Don't wait. So we released a huge amount of oil, right? Huge amount of oil. The use of dispersant was really driven by our focus on the incorrect environments. Dispersant at depth, we have no still really good idea what it actually did. Management was unable to use our scientific skills effectively. And that old spill paradigm led us astray. On Wednesday, we're going to hear about what happened in the Refugio spill. Okay?